So welcome everyone to the second lecture of the winter semester. Last week or 2 weeks ago, we had a wonderful lecture by Mark Ryan of Public Work. And this lecture will be followed by Brad Klopfel of Allied Works in Seattle, who will be coming to speak at the end of March. So we have a good roster of speakers this winter. We wanted to thank the Dutch Consulate for their generous support for this lecture, and also Diamond and Schmidt Architects, who've contributed to bringing Thomas over on Don Schmidt's points. Tonight's lecture by Amsterdam architect Thomas Rau will be followed by a panel discussion that'll last about 30 minutes, and featuring Sheena Sharp of Cool Earth Architect and Mike Szabo of Diamond and Schmidt Architects, who've both been doing quite good work as advocates in sustainable design, both through their work and their project work, but also their committee work in various agencies like the OAA and other committees. So now I'll introduce our speaker. Thomas Rau founded Rau Architects in 1992 and has been at the forefront of producing energy neutral and CO2 neutral buildings as a norm. Well, actually energy positive buildings as a norm, apparently, more recently. I'm having a hard time holding the mic. Thomas was elected as Dutch Architect of the Year in 2013 and awarded with the ARC 13 Oeuvre Award for his widespread contribution in both promoting and realizing sustainable architecture over his career and bringing awareness of the circular economy in the last 20 years through internationally delivered lectures, TV documentaries, TED Talks, and publications. It is this activism and advocacy for environmental stewardship through his holistic and critical thinking about the big picture problems we all face, many issues traditionally seen as outside the bounds of architecture, that makes Thomas's work truly exceptional. He looks at architecture through the lens of the economy and ecology. With his wife and partner, economist Sabine Oberhuben, they've recently published a book called Material Matters that dissects and critiques our current linear systems of production and consumption and waste, and proposes new economic paradigms to radically change the status quo. Thomas not only advocates for these transformations, but facilitates and implements them through his own work and startup companies. He started a company called Turn2 several years ago to assist product manufacturers and to help product manufacturers create a methodology and business plan to transition to a circular economy. With companies like Philips in 2010, he got them to deliver light and power as a service rather than simply light fixtures as a product. There are similar relationships underway with companies like Bosch, BMW, and Schiphol Airport. And I'll just read a quote from Turn2. Turn2 regards the necessary transformations as being a disruptive one, taking place on three levels: the design of products and supply chains, the financial and business models involved, and the mental transformation leading to a new way of thinking, which Turn2 regards as necessary to redefine business activities. With a multidisciplinary team, the company is active in all these fields, working with leading companies that wish to transform into regenerative businesses. So I will turn the platform over to Thomas, and we look forward to seeing his work and ideas. Thank you.
Can you switch off the light? Okay. So, I shouldn't touch anything here, so otherwise so I have to be very careful. Good evening. So there are millions of reasons not to be here. There's one reason to be here, because you want to be here. That's why things are happens, because we really want something. And I want to invite you for a small mental journey tonight, So, and it's all about architecture, but not just architecture about buildings. It's also about the architecture of the new economical system. And from altitude to attitude, I think we are very familiar to altitude, but not so familiar to attitude. But without attitude, there's no altitude. And there was a president, and he said in 1962, you know what, we're going to the moon in this decade. We have no idea how to get there, but we will get there, because we are guided by the future. So if you have no idea where you want to be, so what can you do? So what is the goal? What is the goal of your study? What is the goal to be an architect? What kind of values are important for you? And he said, okay, let's go to the moon. I have no idea, but I know we will get there. So he's guided by the future. So this is a good question. So are we guided by the future, or are we guided by the past? So we had a very nice excursion in the morning, Gerald, and yeah, I think we saw a lot of past. We saw very less future. So, but let's see, what is our past? First, I want to say something about sustainability. I mean, everybody is full of sustainability. It's that, okay, now we are enlightened, and now, oh yeah, we know everything about sustainability. But sustainability is a problem. It's the main problem right now. Because sustainability is optimizing the system. So it's optimizing the past. I think the step we have to do is we have to transform the system, because we are guided by the future. And sustainability is all about the certifications. We call them the sustainable condoms. Huh? So we get points, LEED Gold and Platinum, so everybody's very happy. But do we really change anything? Or is it just a game where we get awards and certifications? The new something is nothing. These are the new business models right now. Maybe you have any idea who that is. This is Airbnb. This is the biggest hotel company in the world. And how much toilets do they clean every day? None. Because they have no responsibility. They just have the power, but no responsibility. You know Uber, the biggest taxi company in the world? How many winter tires do they change? None. But they're the biggest one, because they have the power and not the responsibility. So I think this is very typical for this time, that we have power on one side and we have the responsibility on the other side. This is what happens in the last decade. I think what we have to organize, we have to bring together power and responsibility. And then we have, everybody's talking about climate change. I think it makes really no sense. I mean, climate change is the result of the wrong mindset. So if we want to change the climate, we have to change our mindset. So it's about mind change, not about climate change. And we had that conference in Paris 14 months ago, you know, the COP in Paris, the big climate conference. Everybody was unbelievably happy. And I was asked, so Thomas, so what do you think, what can happen there? So what do you hope will happen in Paris? And I told the journalist, I said, the worst thing what can happen is an agreement. That what happened. Because an agreement means we write down what is possible. But we have to write down what is necessary and not what is possible. Because this planet is not waiting for us. It's not waiting for the next election in the States or whatever. And can you imagine if you have a partner and maybe you have a problem with alcohol and you smoke too much and you'll have a lot of girlfriends, and then you promise your partner, you know what? Okay, I take a decision. In 2030, I stop smoking. In 2040, I stop drinking. And in 2050, maybe I will try not to have any girlfriend anymore. So you would say, what a strange relation do they have? But this relation is manifested in Paris between us and planet Earth. That's what we have written. So what is then really the next step? And let's go to the past. I mean, what happens in the last 4.5 billion years? So this is the age of the Earth until right now. And if we were concentrated, let's say, the 4.5 billion years in 12 months, so we can see, so what happens then in between the 12 months? So it starts over here. Then we have the first forms of life emerge. That was in February. In March, photosynthesis. In September, sex. Then in November, we got the fishes. Just in November, can you imagine? In November, at the end of November, we had plants. At the end of November, we have insects. The animals, the dinosaurs. It was in December, do you remember? Was last month. Then we have the prelates at the 31st of December. We had the prelates. And then, you see now, it was also the same day, a little bit later. It's 11:36. It was us. So, you see, the past is very important. And we are just here on that planet. Just. In the last minutes. And then we try to make buildings. I think maybe this is the first skyscraper. I don't know. This is a Tower of Babel. And I think it's very nice to see because it was very easy to start. I mean, the material was in front of it and the people are living there, so they were making the ground floor, the first floor, very easy. If they have to eat, they just go down in the restaurant and they had food, then they go up again. And then you're on the third floor and the third floor said, yeah, now it's getting a problem, so how do we get the stuff? They're so far away, we have to all the way down and all the way up. And maybe it's better that the people stay there, so we're losing too much time if they go down there to the toilet and to have food, so let's stay them there. So then you go up, and then you see, we never finished this tower, because if you go up, it's getting more and more difficult. And then you have those consultants company, the McKinsey's and Boston, they come with the helicopter, said, oh, we have a good idea, we can bring the material with the helicopter up, and maybe it's a good idea to have a crane. So we see the way we are doing it and the way we are organizing architecture is not very intelligent. And that also comes, I see this is the water flow in Holland in 1953. Then it's from current to urgent because the government said, okay, the water, and now we don't care. Now everybody has to get a washing machine and we have to build infrastructure. We don't care for the water. So they didn't care for the urgency, and that happens. So that means if the urgency is current, it's too late. Have a look to the refugees. They came over, everybody in Europe, everybody knows they will come. Everybody, we have a lot of reports, you can read it. Nobody was acting, they're in front of the border of Europe, and then it was too late. So we have to concentrate ourselves on the urgent things and not the current things. But let's see how we organized the last 24 minutes in December. This is a light bulb, and maybe you know him. It's a very special one. This light bulb is from 1901, and it's still shining. In a fire station in California, and last year we met someone who said there's even another one in Germany. So that light bulb is now running for, let's say, for 120 years. How is that possible? Because if I buy a light bulb right now, maybe over 2 years it's broken, and then I have to buy a new one. It's very simple. Osram and Philips in 1924 said, okay, this is not a good idea. I mean, we really made a solution for light. So now if everybody's buying this light bulb, we have no business anymore. So we have to change that. We have to change our business model. And here you see the birthday cake in Livermore. And even George Bush, he wrote a letter for the birthday of the light bulb. And then on 24th of December, it's a very special day. I mean, with what kind of business partner do you want to have a meeting on 24th of December? And they met each other in Geneva, very close to the headquarters of the FIFA, the football company, because this is a good place to make an agreement. And they said, you know what? It's not a good idea that we made this kind of light bulbs. So let's create a problem. Let's create the problem that after 1,000 hours, the light bulb has a breakdown and everybody has to buy a new one. They grounded the 1,000-hour committee. From that day on, all the light bulbs, they had a breakdown after 1,000 hours. The people, they thought they will buy the solution. But at least they realized we bought an organized problem. So it's impossible to buy something new. New means it's not yet broken. New doesn't exist anymore since, let's say, since 100 years. So every product is designed to fail. Of course, that's their business. And we said, oh yeah, it's broken. Oh, how is it possible? Yeah, it's organized. So all the stuff we buy for the building, they're also organized problems. So we have to think about it. Is it a good idea to buy all that stuff? So we have to design to fail. Then we have another aspect. This is designed to be outdated. And you see what happens down here. You know all of them. But this is the way we consume in the past. I mean, this is a telephone from my grandfather. And I think he fixed him 30, 40 times. And after 40 years, he came up for dinner. And he said to my grandmother, he said, Hannah, I'm so sorry. I really can't fix this telephone anymore. It's really over. We have to collect money for a new telephone. It was in 1953, can you imagine? And now what you see there, we have iPhone 3, 4, 5, 6, 6S, 7, 7S. And I brought you the iPhone number 8. To be very careful here because I'm using it. Ladies and gentlemen, this is iPhone 8, a fantastic smartphone. And some of you are very gay, so what's going on, Mr. iPhone 8, I don't have 7, did I get the email, what is about the Apple Store, did I miss the movie, what happens? So why are you getting nervous? I mean, you have a smartphone. So what is the point? And the point is the way we consume. So what you see here is, this is a smartphone, and the life cycle of the smartphone, let's say, is up to here. This is a timeline. But we are not interested anymore in the life cycle. We are interested in the performance cycle. Said, now I heard you can put 5 apps in place from 4 apps on a row now and on your iPhone. You know what? We call this innovation. It's unbelievable. You know what an innovation is? It's an airplane. It's a washing machine. It's a car. But not that you can put 5 in place instead of 4 apps in a row on your iPhone. It's completely not. I mean, if it's really nonsense, we call it innovation. And that means we are creating more and more waste in our existing system. Then we have, it's exactly the other way around. The producer, he knows, they really like it. And they really want to take care for it a long time. They like a very long performance cycle. But you know what I do? I cut it here. Because then here you go back And you buy a new one because you want to use it until there. This is a light bulb. So bad quality creates waste. So fast innovation, which is not an innovation, is creating waste, and bad quality is also creating waste in our system. And then the last aspect is design to be outfashioned. And you know all this, and you have to change that every year. But let's see about the linear economy. That's the economy, how we organize it until right now. And everybody knows it's wrong. And no one is acting. Yeah, I mean, if you ask a human what is okay or what he thinks, it's mostly completely different if you ask him in his role as a, I don't know, a teacher, a professor, an architect, a CEO, a consul, whatever. And the question is, if we go on in the way we consume right now, how long will it last? Okay, so we are now here on the planet, and luckily we can see the planet from the space. And maybe remember Apollo 8. They had a small problem. They had an oxygen problem. They couldn't come back, and they have to move over. And at least they said, okay, we have 24 hours, and they have a connection problem because the oxygen connection they need to survive was from a circle to a square. And this box is created in Houston in a workshop, 12 hours. They put everything on table, what was in the spaceship, and they built this one. Because the spaceship is a closed system. They couldn't go shopping and said, okay, now let's go shopping and buy some. No. They have to organize themselves inside the spaceship, and the spaceship is a closed system. But the Earth, planet Earth, is also a closed system. And if you're in a closed system, everything is limited. So everything what is physical is a limited edition because we have limited resources. But we are surrounded by unlimited sources. So we live in a system which is closed. I would say we are guests in the system because the round table is served for us, and the round table is a closed system. And we are invited to take place on that table, and we can do something. But then we have to realize everything is limited, but we have unlimited sources around us. And you see here also another space station, and they're using, and they can survive because there is an unlimited sources in space, and that's the sun. That's the energy of the sun, and it's an unlimited source. So we don't have any energy problem. We just have an energy demand. But if you serve the demand with the limited resources, then you create a problem. When you create a problem, you have a lobby. And when you have a lobby, you have a fantastic business model. And you have a fantastic business model, we call it an energy problem. So we have enough energy above there. And the funny thing is that the sun is coming back every year. The sun is producing every year the apple, the orange, the banana, whatever. The scene is apple. They do it again and again. This is what the sun is doing for the first nature. But what is then the sun for the second nature? Because the second nature is everything what we are creating. And I think these are the datas. Because everything what has a data has an identity. And if you have an identity, you know exactly where it is. So you keep it. It doesn't matter where it is, you can keep it. And we have to learn to keep everything in a closed system because everything is limited. And the third source is our intelligence. It's even unlimited. And can you imagine what happens to you every evening? You go home, you start to relax, you said, okay, what a strange lecture tonight, okay, let's have a good night. And then you expect that you get up next morning, you're healthy, and you're full of energy. How is that possible? That 7 billion people are loaded up every night free, without being connected with a grid somewhere. So it's an unlimited sources we can use. Let's go to another aspect, which is very fundamental for our being here. It is our being is temporary. I mean, you're here, you're quite young, and let's say, if I would say, it was so nice today, so I would like to come back over 100 years, so what do you think? Do you have time? And everybody knows, yes. I don't have a look at my agenda. I know for sure I have a day off. Because you're dead. And I also know I won't be here because then I'm dead too. So we know our being is temporary. We know it, but are we aware about that? The interesting thing is that our being is temporary. It's not our being, but everything is temporary. The laptop, the projector, the building, the car, the plane, the city, everything is temporary. Nothing is permanent on that planet. So that's why it makes no sense to design something which is permanent, because everything is temporary. But the consequences of temporarity is permanent. I mean, this you see here, the pyramids, they are still there. And in the city of Cairo, they're fighting every year for the maintenance costs for the pyramids. And the local party, they always ask, so who gave the permission? Now we have to pay for it. So we have to pay for the permanent consequences of a decision from someone who is already dead. So our being is temporary, everything is temporary, but the consequences are permanent. The next aspect is nobody knows the future. Of course not. And that's a good idea that we don't know the future. But if we don't know the future, so how can we make any decision? How can you make a design decision if you don't know what is the future? I think the only way to act is that we take an option. With future. Option means we are aware that whatever we design, whatever we do, it's a temporary something. There will be a moment that we don't need it anymore. Maybe after 3 days, like this one, maybe in 30 years, maybe in 300 years, but everything what we create is temporary. And to make an option with future and not for the future means that first I have to write down what kind of limited editions do I need to create that temporary option? How do I have to design a temporary option so that I can be sure if I don't need the option anymore, I can disassemble the option, and when I finish the option, I still have all the limited editions that I need to create it. And then we come to circularity. Circularity facilitates permanent consequences of temporality. That's it. It's nothing more. It's very simple. We also could say we have to organize ourselves that we keep what we have. And if you go outside, you see we don't keep what we have. We throw it away and we call it a building. That's the way how we act. How can we change the game? How can we change the system? Because the system is the result of all different kinds of business models. So if we want to change the system, we have to change the business models. So it's very simple. So it's not about certifications. So how can we change the business models, and what does that mean? Cheryl mentioned it 7 years ago, 6 years ago. We invited Philip, and we had to restore our office, our interior, and we want to have a new light system and new furniture. So, and we invited Philip and said, okay, Mr. Phillips, you know, I know you're selling organized problems, and we don't want that. We can't take the responsibility for your problems. You know what? We want light. So please deliver light. And we want 300 lux, 1,250 hours a year. That's it. If you think you have to hang up some lights, it's your point. It's not my point. So that guy from Philips, he was quite irritated, and he went back to the headquarters. Halfway, he phoned me. He said, Thomas, I feel I have to do that. But please, never, never inform my boss. Because if we inform my boss, it's over. Because I'm paid for the old mistakes. I have to do the old mistakes, but you asking me a new mistake. And I'm not paid for that. So if I do this for you, please don't talk with my boss. He said, okay, I don't talk with your boss. So he came back, and he was very happy. He said, yeah, I arranged it, and we have a light plan, and yeah, we do like this, and we calculated, and we said, yeah, it's 300 lux, 1,250 hours a year. I said, Mr. Phillips, fantastic. But you know what? Yesterday, I heard in the news that, I don't know if it's true, that you need electricity to deliver light. I don't know if your lights are running on white wine or red wine or kerosene or whatever. But let's say it's true, the bill is for you. It's not for me, because I don't need electricity. You need electricity, it's not me. So the bill is for you. So he was a little bit confused again. And he went back to Eindhoven, and he phoned halfway. He said, Thomas, please don't inform my boss. I mean, I will lose my job, but I really want to organize a new mistake. 3 weeks later, he came back, said, yeah, we made a new calculation. And yes, we said, yeah, maybe if we do it in that way, it's also OK. How is possible? In the past, they really want to sell more and more lights. If you ask the performance, you need less lights. And about the energy, I mean, it's the same with an airplane. If you want to go to whatever, if you go by plane to New York, to John F. Kennedy Airport, I mean, you don't buy a plane. You can't take, I mean, even if you would have the money, you don't want to take the responsibility. And then you buy the performance flight, and then you come in John F. Kennedy Airport. And could you imagine that the stewardess, that she's there and said, yeah, we just calculate the kerosene, so can I give you the kerosene bill? I said, kerosene? I mean, if you need kerosene to bring me here, the bill is for you and not for me. I paid for the performance. So it's the same with the energy and the product, and you see what happens. So this was the first collapse of the guy from Philips. And this was the second one. And you see, we just asked another question. We asked for the performance, another product, and we have an energy reduction 32%. And everything is still the same. It's just another question. It's not a special insulation. We don't put PV cells on the roof and all this kind of tricks. It's just about another culture, how we have to organize what we need. 6 years later, the CEO from Philips Lighting, he decided, okay, we will deliver light as a service worldwide. They call it circular lighting. So in between 7 years from someone who was afraid to talk with his boss about that, after 7 years, the CEO made the decision, this is the main business. They want to have 30% of their turnover in 2025 with circular lighting. They know this is the new business. And you know why Philips is doing that? They don't do it for Mother Earth or whatever. They do it because they still can earn money. but in a different way. And I can tell you they even can earn more money. They earn more money, and it's cheaper for the consumer. So we did it with a lot of stuff. We did it with the whole interior, with furniture. So we have sit hours, table hours, walk hours, look through hours, whatever. And we also did it with washing machines and refrigerators in Amsterdam. Because especially the people with a very low income, they don't have the money for the good machines, so they buy very simple washing machines, and then they get a very high electricity bill because the very simple machines, they need a lot of energy. So this is one of the first refrigerators for the people, and then we did that with firma Bosch, and Bosch was asking, so Mr. Rao, fantastic idea, marketing-wise, it's incredible. So, but I just have a question. I mean, you never know. Maybe there's a moment when there's a problem with one of those machines. So what happens? I said, Mr. Bosch, it's very simple. The people, they pay for the performance. And if you can't deliver the performance, you have to fix it. And then he said, you know, we have a washing machine which is running for 15 years without any problem. But of course, we didn't deliver the machine because we didn't have the business model. But now, we have the business model. So the people in Amsterdam with the lowest income, they have the very best washing machine ever produced by Bosch. Because they ask for the performance and they don't ask for the product. This is Schiphol Airport. It's a new lounge. And the option by Schiphol is always 15 years. It said, okay, our option is 15 years because we know after 15 years, it's over. It's completely outdated. We have to move the whole stuff. So we calculate for 15 years. They need light, which is running 24 hours, 7 days a week. There was just one lamp from Philips, which is running for 6 years. It said, okay, we need 15 years, so we need 2.5 lights. That's not a good business model, especially the half light at the end. So we asked Philips. He said, okay, you know, Philips, is it not a good idea? Maybe it's good for you to deliver light here. Now you've done it with Mr. Rao, so we can do it here again. And then Philips said, okay, yeah, let's give us some little time. We'll come back in 3 weeks. So they came back in 3 weeks, and it's a very funny thing. They said, yeah, we do that, and we just designed a light which is running 15 years. I said, okay, yeah, it didn't exist, but if we deliver light, we don't want to change the lights. We don't want to fix it. We don't want to have the maintenance. So they designed a light which is running for 15 years. And it was a very small trick. I mean, if, let's say this is a light, and then you have the driver here, so the driver is on the top, so the light is in the ceiling. So if you have a problem with the light, you have to take out the whole thing to fix the driver. But if you already took it out completely, it's cheaper to buy a new one. That was the old model. They designed a lamp like this. And the driver was on the right side. And the light was here. So I said, if there's any problem with the driver, there's a click, click. So they don't have to disassemble the whole light. They just change the driver. Because the consequences of their design decisions is now for Philips and not for the consumer. So that means the design will change completely if the producer is responsible for his own product. And of course, this is Magines. Designed for passion. This is a firm in Europe, and there you can get jeans performance based. So you just take it and you use it, and if you don't like it or it doesn't fit anymore, you just give it back. Okay, now we need the next step. And the next step is about waste. And this is a very nice document. This is the first document where sustainability is mentioned. And it's about in the 18th century, there was a German landlord, and He had to cut some trees because he wants to build something. And then he said, okay, maybe even my children, they want to change it. And they also need some wood. So maybe it's a good idea if I cut a tree that I put another tree in the ground so that that tree is big enough when we need a new tree. So they called it Nachhaltigkeit, and in English it's sustainability. But now we have the recycling companies. And we think the recycling companies, they are the solution. I tell you, they're part of the problem because they are part of the system. They optimize the system. Because what is a recycling company doing? The waste is coming in, and they say, okay, this is copper, and oh, this is steel. And they said, this is too expensive to take care for it. We put this in the waste incinerator. And the waste incinerator, in fact, is a crematorium of a limited edition. In Europe, we call this a thermal recycling fabric. And thermal recycling means the electricity you produce in the thermal recycling process is the green energy. So welcome in the world of sustainability. So if you have green energy, you're responsible for the fact that we are burning unlimited resources in a crematorium. So what can we do? So we said, okay, let's make a passport. I mean, if waste is a material without identity, let's give the material an identity. Then it's never be waste. So we can eliminate waste to give all materials an identity. So we create the material passport. And you see one of those sheets we produced in that time of a building. So we know exactly how much wood, what kind of wood, how much steel is in the building, in the elevation, on east side, west side, first floor, eighth floor, whatever. So we know exactly what is in the building. Why? Because everything in the building has an identity. And it's documented in a materials passport. And if you have a passport, you also have some rights, but we mentioned that later. How to organize it? I mean, if we need this passport, I mean, the market for that is 100%, because there are maybe 3 buildings right now with a passport in the world. So we said, how can we collect all this data? And how can we help everybody to make his own passport? So that's what we will do next week. We launch next week Madaster. It's a cadaster for materials. So it's a national platform. So everybody can bring his BIM model or his drawings or whatever. And then we have a software. We developed it with Microsoft. And then everybody can create his own material passport. So in the future, we know exactly how much steel is in this moment in this city. And we also know the value of it. Because if you know the material, you can calculate the value of it. And that means the depreciation is not going to zero. It's going down to the raw material value in the building, because this is what we have written down. It's documented in the passport. It's documented by Madaster. So that means every building is a material mine. But we have no idea, because it's not written down somewhere. We know it's a building, but we have no idea how much glass is here and how much steel is. It's just a real estate. But can you imagine if we would know exactly how much steel is there? And when we demolish a building, then we know, okay, then we get so much steel. In the city, we get so much wood. We have no idea right now. We have done this for a hotel company. They made a new hotel, and they have to demolish the old hotel. They said, Thomas, we are so happy. Yeah, next week, it's going away. And we have to pay for it 1.2 million euros. I said, you have to pay for it? Come on. You should get money. I said, why? Yeah, I said, do you know anything about the material value in the building? No, we just want to get rid of the building. So I said, okay, please give me 2 weeks' time. We will calculate the material value in that building. So we got 2 weeks. And after 2 weeks, we had a small report. Of course, we couldn't check anything. But what we checked in that period, the value was 900,000 euro. So this client was very happy. And the demolishing company, they were very unhappy. Because in first place, they said, OK, first we get 2.1 million to demolish the building. And then we get 900,000 euro for the material. So we can earn 2.1 million euros. So but because the client knows the value of the building, he just paid 300,000 euro to demolish it. So the next step is, if it's a mine, then it's an existing building. But if we design a new building, then we have to design a depot. Because if you design a depot, first you write down, so what do I have? You put it in your depot, you take care for it, and you put it in a way in a depot that if you need it, if you don't need the depot anymore, you can take it out. I will show you another project. We just finished that last year. It's about 20,000 square meters, and it's the first material depot. This is the same building. And you see, the client, he came and said, Thomas, please help us. Nobody wants to work here anymore. It's really over. And we bought that field over here. So we thought maybe it's a good idea that we build up the new headquarter here, and then we demolish that one, and then we have parking here. We just turn it around, and everybody's happy. I said, no, we don't do that. I mean, this is a mine. Do you have any idea what is in your mine? He said, no. I said, OK, let's check what is in the mine. And there's one special thing is, if we have the perspective of abundancy, it's much easier to make a decision. I mean, the abundance we have here, and I hope that you agree, is ugliness. So this is very easy to share. So nobody cares. So we said, OK, we use all the stuff here to create the new building. So we used all the old buildings here, and you see them all back in the new design. And I give you some examples. We put out the ceiling plates. Regular, you throw them away and you buy new ones. So we collect them, we clean them, we paint them, and we put them back. It was 4 euro cheaper than to buy new ceiling plates. There's no ceiling company with this kind of business model. Of course not. They want to sell you new ceiling plates. But for us, it was much cheaper. We asked the people, so do you have any clothes which you don't like anymore, or which doesn't fit, or the wrong color, or whatever? We collect all the clothes of the people. We send them to France. And we got back insulation material. So all the buildings are insulated with old clothes of the people from that company. It's a network company. And they have a lot of those cable trams and pallets. So we collect them all, we clean them, and we put them on the elevation. Very easy. Doesn't cost you anything, because they had the material already. So we put everything out of the mine, and we put it in the new design. So this is the interior of the building. Of course, we have a green lung in the center. But the new elevation is designed by old pallets. And there's another thing. I mean, it's so interesting to look backwards, how people in the history, how they solve problems. And you see here, everybody knows if you bring in light from the top, it's three times more than if you take light from the outside, from the vertical elevations. And then they put this kind of textile. If they don't like the light, they just put the textile on it, or if they want to cook. So it was a very flexible roof. We designed it in the same way in the building. So here you see the building under construction. And here you see those round windows in the roof. And this is a very interesting system because we can steer the daylight by air pressure. So what you see here is this is the opening in the roof, and this is a foil, like here, and we put some textures on the foil. So, I mean, if you could imagine this, these are the two foils, and this is a texture, and you put them together, you can't see me. But if we put air in it, you can see me. So by air pressure, we could steer the daylight in the building very easily. Then we have a curved roof, and it's not just a curved roof. I mean, the roof is steering the warm air in the building just to that place where we want to have the warm air. Because warm air is going up and cold air is going down. So if you lift up your roof on special points, then you know all the warm air will collect here and here, and then you can use it. This is the inside of the building. So what you see here is for 82% what you have seen before in the mine. And then you see a roof here, because we put a big roof above all the different buildings, and it was a steel roof. And of course, if you want that someone is doing it, you ask someone who is used to do it. You put an advertisement, and then you hope that the steel company, that they will calculate the roof, and they will say, okay, it's so much money, and everybody's happy or everybody's not happy, whatever. But we think it's the wrong question to the wrong person. Because what you accept is someone who can realize the roof with less as possible material. But what is the business model of a steel company? They want to bring as much as possible material in the roof because they want to earn much more money. So it makes no sense to ask them. So then we said, okay, whose business model is it to make a steel construction with less as possible material? This is our partner. And we found him. It's a roller coaster. Because he has to disassemble the whole stuff every weekend. And you have to, and he has to build it up every weekend. And he has to transport it. So he wants to use as less as possible steel, because otherwise it's not good for his business model. So we ask him, okay, Mr. Roller Coaster, what do you think? Can you make a roof? He said, no, I never made a roof. Then we said, okay. Can you make a horizontal roller coaster? Yeah, he said, okay, I can make a horizontal roller coaster. And now I'm missing the photo here. So this is the horizontal roller coaster. He made the construction. And what you see is he needs 35% less steel. Same roof than the steel company. Because his business model was exactly the other way around. So here you see some interior photos. 1,500 people are working there right now. And maybe you remember this in the past, this was outside. So you went from one building to another building in the mine, and we just covered it up with a roof. So we have much more square meters. And now I have to go back, there's something with the slides, because I want to show this one. So it's 92% circular, because we use the old material. And of course, it's an energy positive building. Because the company, they asked the consortium, said, okay, you know what, you are the landlord of the building. We don't want a developer. A developer is just doing something, and then he's running away, and he said, okay, I made a good deal. They said, we need a landlord. We want to have a landlord for the building for 15 years. And so we are the landlords, and we have to guarantee that it's an energy positive building. And I can tell you this is very easily to do. I will show you another example as a building, as a material depot. This is an existing monument, and it's from a municipality. And they say, you know what? We don't know what happens in Holland. Just give us for 15 years a new town hall. And after 15 years, you just can take it away. Because we think over 15 years, we doesn't exist anymore. So it's also a depot. So this is the old monument. So we made the new volume around the old monument. You can see it here. These are the different levels. And what happens here, I'm sorry, it's in Dutch, it's the wooden construction. And of course, it's a wooden construction, so we need beams. And then suddenly we got a phone call from the company who's delivering the beams. Said, yeah, Mr. Rao, I know it's not on the drawing and you don't pay for it. I know it's not designed in that way. I just have one question. I said, okay, what is your question? He said, yeah, please, can we make the beams 3 centimeters higher? I said, why? He said, then I know that over 15 years, the value of the beam is 20% higher. So then I know now already what I can do with the beams over 15 years. But that means I have to make the beams now 3 centimeters higher. I said, okay, I'm fine. Let's make them 3 centimeters higher. I don't care. If it's good for your business model, it's also good for my client. This is another building. It's a very ugly building. It's in Driebergen. Huh? In Driebergen, and it's an old laboratory, and it was for students, and it was really a very ugly building, and they want to demolish it. And we said, okay, no, we don't demolish it. We keep everything we have, and we design a new building out of that. And you see now exactly from the same perspective, you will see the new building. So this is exactly the same. And this is from the top. We just cut out the middle part. And we also use the material for the rest of the building. And of course, it's an energy positive building. This is a very big one. This is about 50,000 square meters. This is a big school and a supermarket and a gymnastic hall and a fitness center and all different kind of things together. And we have a kind of exchange program in the building, so we exchange in the building everything we need. This is another school. We finished it some years ago. This school is earning money because they have a school. They earn every year 100,000 euro because we are producing so much energy that they can sell it. So we are selling energy from this building, and this is the inside of the building. And what you see, what is very important is, of course, is daylight. Because in the school building, 70% of the electricity consumption is electric light. So if you bring as much as possible daylight in the building, then it's very good for your energy demand. This is a hotel, and this is a very special hotel. It's running on water. Because you can burn water, and the temperature from the flame is 5,000 degrees. We call it water gas. It's unbelievable. I think it's the hottest flame ever. So, in fact, if you have water and a little bit of electricity, then you can run the whole building. This is a floor plan. And here you can see what is the south and what is the north of the building. So every room has a different relation between inside and outside. It depends what is the position of the room in the building and in relation to the sun. And this is the cladding of the building. This is an experiment in Germany in a university building. So we worked here together with some scientists. And we said, okay, you know what we do here? Let's make a very one-dimensional design. And we want to bring as much as possible daylight in the building. So we made all different kind of daylight calculations. And then you see what happens. So you get a very strange building. And there's something very special with the sunscreens here. I will show you the entrance. And this is the sunscreen system. A regular sunscreen is going from the bottom, from the top to the bottom, right? I don't understand why all the sunscreens are going the wrong way around. I mean, it makes much more sense to let the sunscreen from the bottom to the top. exactly the other way around. And now your question is why? Why is, I mean, if you're on your bureau and you're working and then the sun is coming up, the first thing you do is you put the sunscreen down and then you catch the sun and then you have shadow on your on your table and then you're happy. But the first thing is what you do, you block the daylight. And you block it more and more and more, and then you catch the sun, and then you're happy. If it's the other way around, you just bring up the sunscreen so that you catch the sun, and the daylight is still coming in the building. So you can serve a lot of energy if the sunscreen is going the other way around. It was very difficult to make the product. There was no company who wants to make it. And if you need something which nobody wants to do, you can ask people which are handicapped in a handicapped fabric, and because they don't care what they do. They're happy that they can do something. There's no lobby, whatever. So the first sunscreens are made by handicapped people. And after 7 years now, it's a standard product. So by Dinilux, you can order it right now. This is a very special building in a park. It's a building for people who are working with animals. So regular, we make buildings where people are working for people. But this is a building where people are working for animals. So you see that here, it's in the park. It's also energy positive. It's a very simple wooden construction. This is a building in Lyon. It's an office building, 15,000 square meters. It's the first energy positive building, office building in France. And it's a headquarter of an engineering company who is calculating the energy consumption in a building. So maybe you see that also design that the design is a little bit different because you have different kind of parameters how to make your building. It also can be very simple. This is a very modern house. It's very close to our place. It was not really cheap, I can tell you. But it's also an energy positive building. This is another office building. We finished it some years ago. This is a laboratorium. So all the buildings are different because the place is different, the location is different, the function is different, the client is different, everything is different. And this is another office building. And here we tried to make a building with 100% glass. We didn't get there. I think it's about 91%. Because it's unbelievably important to bring as much as possible daylight in your building. And it's a retail company. They're also for fashion. So this is a reception here. And in the evening, they just put away all the stuff, and then there's a catwalk, so they walk on the table in the building. And this is the inner patio of the building. This is a theater, an opera, in Den Haag, in the center of Den Haag. It was a competition. And I just want to show a small movie how we present the building. These are the different functions. They were at different place in the city, and they want to concentrate all dancers and all musicians in one building with different theaters. This is a program of the different users, the orientation. These are the main halls. So it's a kind of instrument. And on top there was a school. the logistic in the building. Okay, so that was about the material mine, material depot. Now we have a material bank. This is the headquarter of the most sustainable bank in the world. It's a Triodos Bank, and this is a headquarter, and it's a completely remountable building. It's energy positive, and it has a wooden construction in the center. And this is a floor plan of the building. It's on a very nice, it's in a park. So it was very delicate to get the permission for that building in the park. And this is a building as a modular system. Because I think the builders, they still think they have to build a building. I think they have to learn it's just a logistical process with the result, a building. So this is the headquarter of the European headquarter of Shimano. This is a floor plan. It's a modular system. We finished the building in 8 months, so it was very short, 3,500 square meters, and the builder was very happy. He said, "I earned a lot of money." I said, "Because it was very logic to do it because it was a modular system." These are the different floor plans in the building, and. We just opened it 2 weeks ago with Mr. Shimano. Now he's about 80 years old, and he's really a very interesting man. Then a building as a machine. We got a question from the airport. He said, "Thomas, please, we want to be the greenest airport in the world. So can you design us the greenest terminal ever? What does it cost, and how long do you need?" And we told him it needs 2 seconds and it costs you nothing because a green terminal is a terminal you never build. But then we said, but if you want an airport with future and a platform for innovation, we can work on that. So this is the design, and let's see what happens. This is yesterday's scale. That's the way how we did that, let's say 80 years ago. And this is the last innovation in that sector, and you know from what period that is? It's from 1953. So this is really the last innovation in the in the flying sector. This is today's scale, so it's very busy, but in fact nothing changed. And this is the way how we design airports, because this is a completely one-dimensional answer on a very complex phenomenon. And this happens around an airplane. I mean, if you land somewhere and you look out of the window, you said, "My goodness, didn't they know that we come?" So I think they asked everybody just to help, just to clean and to take the suitcase, and oh my God. But it's not an incident, it's a phenomenon. This happens million times a day, that they organize this chaos around an airplane. Since 100 years, it's unbelievable. So we said, okay, let's do it the other way around. Because we think that the capacity of an airport is defined by the gates. I mean, Schiphol has 120 gates, but there was not even one day that 120 airplanes came in the same second they came down. It's impossible, because the capacity is defined by the space. That's why all the planes come sequentially down, and they go sequentially, they leave the terminal. So we said, maybe we just make a turnaround terminal, so the planes are coming in here sequentially every 3 minutes, every 5 minutes. This is a moving platform. So this is our machine. So the plane is coming to the passenger. It's not that the passenger is going to the plane. Everything is exactly the other way around.
An interesting fact about airport layouts is that runway processes feed and relieve airports in a sequential manner, whereas terminals handle aircraft in a parallel manner. On the air side, as a consequence, terminals offer capacity that the runways cannot handle. With this in mind, why not organize the terminal building just like runways and make it sequential? This way, the capacity of runways and terminal buildings could be in perfect balance. In order to come up with a sequential terminal, we imagined a circular building which stands at the center of a large disc-shaped apron designed to automatically handle incoming aircraft. The circular building and the rotating disc contains all resources necessary for all airside and landside services. Incoming aircraft are automatically picked up and parked by a guided hovercraft and will then start a step-by-step process on the revolving platform. Meanwhile, on the other side of the platform, a serviced aircraft will be leaving. Organization is such that all regular airside turnaround procedures can be executed on a strictly clean apron basis. The rotating disc has 8 positions. One position is for entry of new aircraft, one is for exit of a serviced aircraft, one is always vacant. 5 positions are always occupied and serve as docking stations that implement the aircraft handling process. This way, the turnaround time is fixed, for instance 30 or 45 minutes, depending on requirements. Let's do a floor-by-floor exploration of the iPort. From this level, arriving passengers are either guided upwards to immigration, security and transfer, or downwards for a 100% security check. Departing passengers descend to this level to stay in the central lounge area. There is commercial space for shopping, food and beverage, or time to relax with a constant view of the boarding gate and the passing aircraft. The circulation level connects the iPort with the terminal and other iPort modules. Domestic and international passenger flows are separated. Also here, passengers have a spectacular view over both the lounge area and platform. To minimize energy use, the rotating part of iPort is a caisson that floats on water. It carries the apron and aircraft, and holds all technical installations, including storage and supply for fuel, water and wastewater. Electricity and luggage are supplied from the central building to the apron and onwards to the aircraft. And how does the iPort enhance travelling into a unique user experience? A departing passenger arrives at the iPort at the top level. A curved roof, partly constructed from glass, lets daylight penetrate deep into the entire building. The natural light guides passengers intuitively to the boarding gate. Descending towards the mezzanine level, one has a spectacular view of the interior of the iPort lounge and aircraft in process, through which a sense of space and peace of mind is felt. Contrary to traditional terminals, iPort provides a passenger experience in which waiting and shopping are combined in direct proximity of the aircraft. iPort not only provides a cost-effective, innovative solution to streamline the aircraft handling process, but will also create a unique passenger experience.
So we're running a little bit out of time, so I just stopped the movie. But you see what happens. Everything is in a completely different way. The terminal is 50% of the cost of a regular terminal. The movie is from 2012, and we engineered the whole terminal now in the last 4 years, and now we try to sell the machine. To sell the machine to different kind of airports. I want to go to the next step. We said product is a service, but the next step is that material is a service, because material is a limited edition. So that means we have to organize the chain in a completely different way. This is our chain. This is Earth, the the state, the mind, the service desk, supplier, producer, and the user. So if we talk about product as a service, we just talk about the relation between the producer and the user. So but who is the owner of the material? It couldn't be the producer. The owner of the material is still, of course, the mine. The mine shouldn't sell the material. They just give it to the world and they ask just money for it. That, okay, if you want to have it, you can have it. You can have it for 30 years. So we make an agreement here, but after 30 years, I want to have it back. So in the forward direction, we have the value creating chain, value create chain. In the backward direction, we have the value sustain chain. So that means whatever it is, it's somewhere here. It's somewhere in this library, and it's exactly documented. So it will never be waste. That means material is a service. What are the benefits? I mean, for the Earth, it's stability. For the states, recurring revenues. For the mine, financing closure. We all know the problems. For the services, it facilitates abundance. The supplier, he just can add value. He's not earning money because he has the material. And then the producer, he's making products without buying materials. And then a product is a service. So a product is a service is the last step in the new chain. So we nearly finished. These are the United Nations. And we just mentioned that the material shouldn't lose its identity. That's why we give the material passport. And if you have a passport, you have rights. You have the right for rights. These are the first human rights which are written down. Eleanor Roosevelt, 1948, 10 December. After the Second World War, they said, okay, maybe it's a good idea to write down what are the value of a human being. So we have the Universal Declaration of Material Rights. We have written the Universal Declaration of Material Rights. Because a material has a passport, and the material, we need material to exist. So if we want to keep it, we think material, they have to have rights. And next year, on 10 December 2018, if New York still exists, we go to the United Nations, and then we will hand over the Universal Declaration of Material Rights. And there's also one misunderstanding in the United Nations, but the only member with a final veto is nature. It's not the Chinese or the French or the Americans or the British or the Canadians or whatever. It's nature, because nature makes life possible. So it's about attitude. This is the first photo which is taken from planet Earth, Christmas night, 1968. Before that date, there was no environmental movement. And I just want to finish with Copernicus, because Copernicus in 1542, he looked out of the window, he said, okay, it's about the sun and the earth and the Catholics. I don't know. I doubt. He was not sure. I mean, he was not really sure. But then was Galileo Galilei, 1610. He had a telescope. And he said, oh, wait, it's exactly the other way around. The Catholics, they tell us everything is moving around the earth. But it's not true. Everything is moving around the sun. So he sent an SMS to the Pope. He said, Johannes, you're not right. It's exactly the other way around. So that means if we realize that everything is the other way around, we feel very uncomfortable. And in the very beginning, I said nobody knows the future, but maybe that's not true. Maybe art knows the future. So I want to finish with art. This is Marina Abramovic. Maybe you know the performance in the MoMA in New York. And she was sitting there for 180 days. She you had white clothes or red clothes, exactly on the same chair, in the same position, in the space, and the visitors, they were coming, they were waiting days to get there, and they were sitting there just to be her guest. So it was completely clear, the visitor is the guest. She realized, in this conversation, I'm the guest. It's completely the other way around. And what happens? It's a very uncomfortable situation for her to realize that it's exactly the other way around. I think that's what we are. If we realize that everything is the other way around, it creates, in first place, a very uncomfortable situation. So, let's go to Bhutan. I was advisor of His Majesty, the King Wangchuck, and it's really a great man. And he said, you know, Thomas, every child has a talent, but mostly they're on the wrong school. And he said, you know, we come with nothing and we leave with nothing. And we have to learn that we have to identify ourselves who we are and not what we have. So why do we want to own something? We can take it with us. And then I realized that we are not human beings on a spiritual journey, but we are spiritual beings on a human journey. Even this is exactly the other way around. And how can we get there? From attitude to altitude, we need leadership. And I think this is one of the biggest problems in this time. There are no leaders anymore. We give some people the role of a leader, but mentally, they are not the leader. And I hope that you take the responsibility in architecture, that you also take a kind of a leadership role in the way how you design the building, and that you get aware that we are guests on the planet, and that round table is served for us, and we didn't design it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Thomas. I'm so glad you ended with art. Art working alongside to make it human. We're just going to assemble our panel on the stage. I'd like to offer this chance for members of the audience to ask questions of Thomas. Are there any questions in the audience? Yes?
You want to buy space for me?
I want to buy living space for, I think, 25 years. So how can I ask you to do that for me?
Now, I think this is a good question for an architect, because an architect is delivering space for life. So it's delivering space so that you can develop yourself. But then the first question is, where do you want to be over 25 years?
Well, make it 10, I don't mind. But I guess the real point of my question is, if you want to change the economy, it's not going to happen unless companies can profit, right? That's
yeah.
What you said. Isn't it the case that it would take a lot of investment before the event in order to make that change?
Okay. Yeah, I think that this is really good question, but let's take the case of Philips. I mean, in the beginning, it was just a problem, and they have 10 lights, and they have to take it back. So, if you keep it small, it's a problem. If you scale it up, it's an opportunity. So we scaled it up. We said, okay, maybe you get 100,000 of this kind of, you get it back. What happens then? So then they were calculating, and then after weeks, they were realizing that they can earn more money, service-based, than they can buy, than they can earn with the products. So in fact, service-based is a much better business model than product-wise. That's why they changed the business in between 7 years. That's why they say in 2025 they want 30% of the turnover by circular lighting. So it's I think if we want to change the reality, the only ways we have to show what are the financial incentives if you change your perspective. Because the financial side is the reflex of the old system. And if we want to change system, we have to surf the reflex of the old system to introduce the new system.
Even
for a small company, it's even easier. Yeah, I showed you Mud Jeans. It was a startup. We have bicycle companies. So we have a lot of startup companies. They start with the service. They never have an idea just to sell a product. And the funny thing is that if you are a production company, your turnover on the 1st of January is zero. If you're a service company, it's never zero. Because you have all this kind of contracts. So the risk of your business is going down in time. So it's a much easier business. So we talk with BMW, with Bosch, with Philips, with all these different companies, and they just realized if we do it the other way around, we can earn more money. And that goes very quick. I mean, Philips, they turned over in between 7 years. I think this is quite quick for a big corporate. But the financial incentive is the key. That's what I think.
Any other questions? Okay, well, why don't we bring our panelists to the stage? Sheena Sharp and Mike Szabo. Sheena Sharp is a partner at Cool Earth Architects and has been practicing for 25 years in the city and advocating for high quality sustainable architecture. Mike Szabo, also an architect and principal at Diamond Schmidt Architects, has been practicing here for approximately the same amount of time and has also been advocating measuring systems within his practice, developing a mechanism called ecometrics to try and bring measurability within the profession to all the various measures and many conflicting measures for gauging the success and failure of various green buildings. So I'm going to take a seat too. And I'll grab my mic. Well, I guess we can see each of the mic.
You can take that one. You can take that one.
Okay, thanks. All right. So maybe you might want to say a little bit about your own practices and thoughts about implementation and why aren't we advocating a circular economy here in this city yet? Why are we still stuck on can we get to 50% better than we were, 10 years ago?
Well, I think one of the things that I've realized, and I think that there was a lot that resonated with what you said that is applicable here, and one of the things is to say, what is necessary, to be guided by what is necessary and to be guided by where we want to go. Because in our industry, I think we've been guided for a long time by saying, oh, well, we could do a little bit better. Well, how much better do we need to be? And we haven't hit that. And I think you know, we're starting to, with the, you know, I really admire Ed Masria also, and in being able to set a target that's in line with the 2030. And so we've been, I think that that's an issue. I also think an issue, like I've spent a lot of my time advocating for architects. I was president of the OAA. I would go into rooms with other people. They have no idea what architects do, don't particularly care. The whole effort of trying to reach across and to say, we have some of the solutions, how do we get your attention, has been really, really became, is the crux of, I think, what we have to do. And one of the things, as both as a practicing architect, we end up being handcuffed by the planning systems that we've been creating and by the business systems that we work within and by the procurement systems. And again, how do we break out of this? And I think one of the things that I'd be interested in hearing your response, one of the things that we are struggling with or that I think is coming up in the next 5 years is our grid. Because right now we have utility companies across North America, some of whom are rejecting PV, some of whom are welcoming it, some of whom are rejecting everything and trying to go back to coal, something like that. And their basic problem is their business plan doesn't work anymore, and they know it. And they can't figure out. And so that the reaching across, like the Rocky Mountain Institute is trying to do some things to bring people together. I know our utility companies are all over the place. I work with a utility company up north who is totally open to this. How do we create a transactional grid? How do we become a service and not a purveyor of electrons? You know, and so I think some of those, the issues that you've talked about, I think we're grappling with those issues here. And we're also, our provincial government has passed a bill last year that nobody paid attention to called the circular economy. And when you read through it, I think it's really important for us to take some of your ideas and think about it, because they give themselves a whole whack of powers. And part of me says, oh my God, it's gonna be like lead for everything and we're gonna have to count everything because they have this power to make us tell them this, that, and the next thing, and okay, we can do that. But I think it's all sort of right now directed at, here's the waste stream and it's gonna get bigger because we'll have more people and how do we divert it at the end? And if we start to think about some of these ideas, like it's a period right now where the government is looking for ideas. And if we start to think about some of the ideas, we may be able to change the course. It's a moment in time where that could happen.
Now, so what you mentioned about the grid, we have in Holland, we already have the problem. I mean, Holland is much smaller, so every problem we have much quicker than you because you're a huge country. So it's a long time that you really have the problem. In Holland, we have it very quickly. So we have the grid problem in Holland because we have a lot of electrical cars. So we have, in the whole country, we have chargers, we have superchargers from Tesla, a lot of people that have PV cells. So the network is not prepared for this kind of transition, because the old network is we have a fabric, we centralize everything, and from there we just send energy in the country. But now everybody is producing energy and is coming back, and how calculate this. So this is, even in Holland, a huge problem, so it's not solved yet. But what we decided is that we cut off the grid for gas. So we said in 25 years, there will be no gas in Holland anymore. So we want that everybody is switching over to electricity. But to be honest, nobody knows how that will work. The only thing is they know we have to do it. Yeah. And then we have to figure it out. If we wait until we figure it out, it's too late.
And one of the things for designers that I would hope that we could get them, that we could come to an agreement that we as a community, like we design buildings, I've designed buildings that load shift only from day to night. Mm-hmm. And, but do they need day to night? Right now they say they do, but depending on how they're shaving peaks, they might need buildings to be more flexible. They might want buildings to shift from night to day or from, you know, and we are designing systems that shift from season to season because, you know, our ancestors in Canada, they dug up ice from the lake, they put them in straw houses, and then they used the ice all summer long. This is how you shift energy from seeing, like, so we're starting to design buildings that can do things like that, but how, but the grid doesn't know that. They don't know how low we can go in terms of our energy. Like, the people who are running those things, the forms you have to fill out to get $500 to put in a high efficient gas boiler, like, it's ridiculous, it's ludicrous, right? That's the system that we work with.
Yeah.
So how we need to envision how our buildings can become flexible enough to participate in this transactional thing.
Yeah, I mean, we need very intelligent buildings.
Yeah. And we don't have them now. It's a challenge for, like, all of us.
But it's like Kennedy. I mean, if he would wait until they really know how to get to the moon, it will never happen. So we need the agreement what we think is necessary. And there we have to work on, and then we figure out how to get there. But what we do now is, so what is possible? So let's do what is possible. And if you just do what is possible, there's no effort. So we have to do it the other way around. And of course, it could be a very uncomfortable situation. Okay, so what? But that's what we have to do.
Yes, exactly. So we can't do that. Well, we have to.
Well, and that's a design problem itself. It's got to come from architects and engineers and designers that have to envision an opportunity or another way of doing things before we can get to the next step of enforcing, creating regulation and enforcing regulation. So,
but in Switzerland, they decided that you don't get any permission of a building if it's not an energy neutral building. Just from one day to another. They said, we have no idea what the consequences are, but then we see, we have to figure it out. But we don't want to have the old stuff. So if you don't design an energy neutral building, no permission. What happened in Toronto if you would say that here? Everything will be different.
Mm-hmm. The thing that it strikes me, and to address Cheryl, your question, I would say many of the projects that we work on don't necessarily have the same clarity of purpose that you talk about in terms of the lighting in Philips, for example. We'll have a project where there are conflicting agendas between the occupants, the developer, the contractor, the financier, and in order to achieve what you're aspiring to, I guess that's the trickiest question is, and if it's not imposed by governmental agency, how do you bring some consensus of purpose to what amounts to a very complex enterprise, which is, you know, the construction of a building? I don't know if you've got thoughts on that. I mean,
yeah.
It's easy when you talk about something, a device, a particular appliance, a light, where there's a very singular functional purpose, but when there's conflicting agendas in terms of what is what defines success or a good design, and often you can have conflicting agendas.
Yeah.
And a perfect example of that is natural light. Of course, everybody loves natural light. It's a great, what makes a good sustainable building. It also is the very, especially in Canada, it's a very challenging thing to deal with in terms of thermal heat loss. So how do you balance these two conflicting agendas in a way that makes sense? And I'm curious, a lot of your portfolio, for example, they're very lovely, glassy buildings, and they're also net positive. I'm curious to know how you balance those conflicting agendas in a way which makes sense within the confines of a project.
Yeah. I think one of the problem is that we have developers. I think in some years, I hope the profession developer doesn't exist anymore. Because we are serving the developers because we are very happy that they spend their money to make this kind of buildings. So what we need is we need landlords. And the landlord, he can facilitate all the different agendas. So my suggestion is the landlord has to ask the permission. And that person who is asking a permission of a building, he has to take care for the building, let's say, at least for 15 or for 20 years. So then everything will be completely different, completely decisions, Because the problem is the developer, because the agenda of the developer is completely a different agenda than what we need in our society. So we shouldn't give any developer the possibility to create a building, because they create a problem and not a building. Mm. It's exactly what you mentioned.
Yeah, yeah.
No, and the city is so happy that the developers are coming along and they want to do something. It's completely nonsense. It's exactly the other way around. So we have to change the whole game and not fix the game.
Yeah. I mean, you could say the same. I sat on a round table talking about energy efficiency and sustainability in the academic environment. And what was fascinating, so there were representatives from a number of institutions across Ontario, and the common theme was simply that they could not innovate on the construction side simply because the operational budget and the capital construction budget were completely isolated. And it was such a simple problem to solve, and yet it's actually legislated into the organization of all of our lovely institutions, and the solution is right there at hand. You simply cannot port money from one side to the other. Now, that said, there are a number of institutions that have set up green funds to allow for operational dollars to be transferred into a green or sustainable fund to allow for construction of sustainable buildings. But it's really the restructuring of our organizations which is critical in order to allow that inherent contradictions to be broken.
Yeah.
Now, we do have a mechanism in Ontario that lots of other countries are using design. It's sometimes called P3 or design, build, finance, maintain, and though that concept is very much kind of embedded in, or one could imagine it's coming from the same idea you're talking about of stewardship of a project from start to finish, and therefore it ought to lead to efficiencies and economies and higher levels of quality. Just curious what people think about that. I mean, there's been a lot of discussion about the success and failures of those mm-hmm. projects. They often lead to very expensive buildings per square foot. Just wonder if you have those in Holland.
No, we have this kind of PPS construction. So for schools and for universities or for opera or whatever, but mostly it's ended up in a big conflict, because then the building is an answer on the requirements which are defined by the municipality, but the municipality they are not the expert to ask that. So. That's the problem. So then they give the answer on the question, but it was a wrong question, so they get a wrong answer. So they get a bad building, and the maintenance costs are much too high. So then they have the conflict, and then they sell the building. That's what happens in Holland. So we had a lot of those PPS constructions, and after 2 years, the PPS company, they just sell the whole thing because they don't want to take the risk anymore, because it was a very bad building. What happens here, I showed you that building where we are part of the consortium, so we have to take care of 15 years for that building. We had a client, he said, you know what, we have no idea what we can ask. We just can tell you what we need. So maybe you can help us if you hear what we need, what we have to ask. So there were three consortiums, so we worked 3 months together with three consortiums, with a client, to figure out what is your question. That was a perfect process. So they said, we are not the expert, you are the expert, so please offer us the very best for what we need. But we can't ask what we need. We are not an expert. For us, to make a building is an incident. For you, it's a phenomenon. So you're the expert in everything. So then we showed them what we want to do, and then they got three different designs with three different guarantees, and then they decided for one concept. And we are now, as a designer, we are also responsible for the building together with a contractor, with a builder. So we have to take care 15 years for the buildings. And the client is fine. He knows exactly what it costs. He's paying a special fee every year, 15 years long. And the risk is for us and not for him. Of course, he's not an expert. We are the expert. So it's a completely different game and a completely different kind of where the responsibility for the decisions will come in the future. And what you say about the OPEX and CAPEX, the investment cost and the maintenance cost, the developer is only steering along the axis of investment cost, not the maintenance costs. So the maintenance costs are for the user and not for the developer. So his interest is to make a very cheap building, and if the maintenance costs are very high, he doesn't care. A landlord, he will always balance. So what do I have to invest? What are the maintenance costs? Maybe it's not a good idea. Maybe I spend a little bit more here, and then I know the maintenance costs are lower. So you have to put this conflict in one party, in the landlord. And he will solve it, I'm sure.
So I think part of our problems with P3s are more, I mean, that's a very interesting twist on it. Because part of the things that happen with P3s here are the people who are designing it aren't really allowed to talk meaningfully to the people who are using it. And so sometimes we end up with buildings that, and also there's a little bit of a shroud of secrecy. No one's actually telling you what the real numbers. It's very carefully designed to move political risk as much as any other type of risk, right? And so it's interesting that you were the designer. And there were three consortium who were builders only, not builders and designers?
Builders and designers.
Builders and designers.
Exactly the same, yeah.
Okay. So how are you, how did you then become responsible for the building?
No, everybody was responsible. So
we
offered, at least after 3 months, we offered a question.
Mm-hmm.
And we offered an answer for that question. And we have to price it. So they had three different prices. Three different consortiums, and they're all three, they have the responsibility to take care for the building for 15 years. So it was up to the client, it's A, B, or C. And no risk.
Because they're essentially becoming tenants.
I mean, it's the same. It's the same if you buy a car, you can go to Volkswagen, you go to BMW, or you go to Lincoln or whatever. And the car's ready, and they take care for the car. You just buy the car and you use the car, and you don't say, okay, I'm expert. I think the engine should be turned around, and I need six doors or whatever. They are the expert. They offer you something, and then you say yes or no.
I mean, my understanding of a good P3 and the way they're designed to operate here, and they don't always all operate that way, is that there is that choice. You get competing firms, each trying to deliver a different version, and the developer takes responsibility for the lifespan of the project, maintaining it, and leases it back to the user. So very similar to what you're talking about. And what's important is what happens up front and how the design process is orchestrated. And sometimes there's an independent group that are set up to design the project with the owner in collaboration with the owner, and they set up the kind of design parameters and objectives for the project.
But the in your example, they all give an answer on the same question.
Exactly. Yes.
And in our case, they give all an answer on three different questions because they were given the question. Because out of the working with the client.
Mm-hmm.
Because the client would say, we don't know what our question is. We just need 1,500 people here on that side. And we want to have it very comfortable. So that's what the only thing. So we were designing our own question, and then we were designing the answer for that question. And that's what we offered to the client.
Mm-hmm. You're throwing out a lot of the traditional expectations of a client-user relationship, you know, that
yeah.
whether it's whether it's prescriptive or not. I mean, a lot of clients don't get a good building if they prescribe too much, but they may not get a good building either if they don't give any intimation of how they want to live or how they want to use a space or what they're like or what their favorite color is or any of those kinds of things.
Yeah, but mostly if a client wants to have a building, then he's calling a project manager, and the project manager, he's helping the client. And then the client thinks, okay, this is a good person. But a project manager, he has his own business model. So everything he's doing is along his own business model. He's not helping the client. Mm-hmm. He's serving his business model on the platform of the client.
You know, before today's conversation, I would have always argued that the best client is one who takes ownership of the project for themselves. And I wouldn't have argued that the best client is somebody who is a purchaser of a certain. I mean, it's in many ways turning the building into something that provides a service for a fee. And I've always found whenever there's that tension, that there's a lack of accountability and ownership, and there's an inherent tendency to push risk off. And as an owner, one assumes that responsibility and to some extent takes decisions that looks out for the future of the decisions that they're taking. In your presentation, you tend to say, you know, and the end of ownership, and I understand it in a conceptual sense, but within the confines of an architectural project, I find it troubling, and I'm not entirely sure whether I'm just hanging on to antiquated the past and not thinking about the future. And I'm just wondering, what are your thoughts on that sort of?
I'm not at all against ownership. But ownership means that you have to be aware for what you take the responsibility. And in the most of the case, it's impossible to take the responsibility because you don't know and you're not aware of it. And in fact, if you don't want to do it, it's a lower risk. I give you an example. Yesterday we talked about the KLM, the Dutch air company. They have those planes, but they are not the owner of the engines. Because they say, if we buy the engines, then we know we have a lot of problems. So we stay on the ground, we have to fix the engine, we can fly, and Rolls-Royce is coming in, and they fix it, a lot of problems. They say, you know what? I want to have fly hours from you. You take the engine, you are the expert, so you know the very best that we don't have any problems with our engine. So they're buying flight hours, so they have less risk because they don't want to take the responsibility. And they give the responsibility to that one who can be the owner of the responsibility, and that's Rolls-Royce. So it means if you're not the owner, it's a lower risk.
Right. But if you're not taking the risk, are you necessarily making the right decisions? And this is, I think, for me, I think there's a risk in pushing off risk, so that, I mean, in the case of KLM, do they care if Rolls-Royce is making the right sustainable choices in the way they manufacture their engines? In the end, they only get what they ask for and are prescribing, and nothing else.
No, what KLM? I understand what you mean. But what KLM is doing, they just frame the requirements, and in between this frame, they're searching for someone who can guarantee the performance of the engine.
Right.
So, but they give the frame. It's not just, okay, I don't care, so if you have an engine, I'm fine. No, This is the frame. In between this frame, you have to deliver us the service. And this frame is every year, it's a different frame. Because every year they have new idea what they want about the engines.
So I think it's always like most of the things we design, there's a point where one of the first things you do is identify the point where things will meet. And I, like, if on a simple, I remember I was talking to Frank Gehry's computer guy, and how exactly do you issue shop drawings, right? And he said, well, we don't do real 3D models. We define the point that the curtain wall is supported, and the curtain wall guys meet that point, and the structure meets that point. You define that point. And so you're kind of talking about, okay, you're moving the point. And so if I was, say, running a school, I would define what I want to take responsibility for, which might be having educated students pop out the end after 3 years or 4 years or six or whatever. And then there has to be that point whereby I am asking for something that I'm taking responsibility for, and you will deliver that and take responsibility for that, right? So you're essentially saying that with the project that you worked on, the owner took responsibility for the functional requirements and then had a discussion with, so the designers, everything you've talked about, like turning things on their heads, understanding how the whole system works, understanding how the chain works. So you're saying the owner took responsibility for the knowing the outcomes that they wanted, and then challenged each of these consortiums to come up with an answer that met those outcomes. So the point became not so much, we often produce, or compliance architects sometimes produce, they're not called prototypes, whatever the heck they're called, those. And they essentially almost do a partie of the building, the layout of the building, the rooms and things like that. That's not where it went, right? It went to, we're going to have a conversation, as we often have with conversations, as we have had traditionally. You know, you sit down. It's not like I can design a house and give it to you. You have to tell me where you want your spoon drawer or whatever, right? And so, but it's a conversation, right? Mm-hmm. And so the problem I think we have in Ontario right now is it's not a conversation. We design these compliance drawings that say, you need 6 nails between this point and this point. And then we get pass it out, someone comes back and says, well, we can produce that for this much money. And so we're missing that conversation somehow, and that understanding of where the responsibility is, if I'm making any sense mm-hmm. at all. Mm-hmm.
Any final comments? I think this is a conversation that will never end. it's deep and it's complex, and I think all of us are having a little trouble imagining how it operates at the level of a building. It's easier to understand at the level of a product, but buildings and their generation are so complex. But
you didn't answer one question. And it was your question, and you said, how the heck do you get a net positive building with so much glass? And that might be because we're used to deep in winter, but how do you do that?
Yeah. In five minutes or less.
Just give us the overview.
I mean, the electricity consumption of the lights in the building is about 60 or 70% in an office building, right?
No, not here.
No, okay.
The ventilation would be bigger because we can't blow 20 below air on people. We have to heat it up first.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay. So, but that means if you bring as much as possible daylight in the building,
yeah.
It means that you reduce your energy consumption.
Yep. Yes.
So that's why we have done that. And it's triple glass in the building.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
and that's it.
Okay.
So it was less than 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and thanks for your attention. Oh, one last question.
I just had a question for
Tom.
So might be personal, but do you think greed is necessarily taught? Because if it is, then it can be untaught. So do you think greed is something, a natural human component, or something that can be taught?
I don't get the question.
She's, if I can repeat the question, she's asking whether you feel that greed becomes a factor.
Greed, being greedy. Okay.
And is it something that is taught? And if it's taught, can it be untaught? Is that?
I mean, maybe I repeat what I said in the lecture. What the king of Bhutan was saying. He said we have to learn to define our identity, not towards what we have, but who we are. And if we learn this, then everything is eliminated. That's it. I mean, it's really back to the roots. Back to the fact that we are human beings, and that we are not here to consume something. We are here to figure out who we are and why we are here in this time. I think that's the main thing.
Do people call you optimistic on your ideas about net zero buildings and climate change?
Of course, I'm very optimistic. I'm very, very optimistic because I know we can change everything like this. You can decide right now, I stop my university here and I go to Australia, you take the plane, you're gone. You can do it by yourself. We are all free people because we belong to the brand human. So everything can change in one night. And I expect that I wake up in the morning and said, okay, yesterday everything was different. And we see it in the politics that we need one to change the whole game. So everybody of us has the power to change the whole game. So I'm very optimistic because it can happen every moment. About climate change, it's completely different because I mean, the climate change now is the result of what we have done 50 years ago. So if we say, okay, we will fix it until 2050, which is completely nonsense, okay, let's say we fix it, that means we have the result in 2090. So this is completely crazy to do. So about climate change, I'm not optimistic. I think we focus a real big problem in what is all about the climate change, and we don't speed up enough, and we have to speed up enough. So I'm optimistic about the change from the system, but I'm not optimistic about climate change because we don't steer it anymore. Earth is steering it, not us.
So really the big issue is we all need to be advocates like you, and we all need to advocate for some big regulatory changes. Okay, thanks everyone.